tinc el balt d'Iseria, jo decidiré complir. Issues? Ok. So the last day we were at the building, what happens? We last this time with the spherical symmetry. I want you to try to study your SC behavior and the solutions. So, out of the horizon, this is a very interesting problem to discuss how geodesics, how a photon or a observer can be swallowed by the black hole, be detected by it. But for the issues in space-time singularities, we want to know what happens to something that is inside the horizon. Okay. So in the Schwarzschild solution, as we saw Tuesday, there is no other possibility for a particle but to go to the center of the solution. Okay. So we discussed this explicitly. And what happens to these geodesics that go through the center of the black hole is that in the case of null geodesics with an angular momentum, they get to the center of the black hole and they cannot be extended beyond this point. Okay? Essentially because the radial coordinate is positive always. You get to the center in finite time for the five parameter, and there is no possibility of extension. Okay? So the geodesics are incomplete. It's enough to have one single geodesic that is incomplete to state that the space-time is singular. Okay? So in the case of Schwarzschild, not only photons can reach the horizon and end there, so this will mean that that information can be destroyed in the center of a black hole. But there are also the time-like geodesics with angular momentum can also get to the center of the black hole and be destroyed there. So it's, they disappear there, okay? This is for the Schwarzschild solution. If you study the same problem with Reznor Nostrum, so instead of having this function for Schwarzschild, you add the Charles step and study the same problem. You find some differences, essentially because the nature of the central singularity is different. In the case of Schwarzschild, it's a space-like, and Reznor Nostrum is time-like. When you study this equation with the method of the Nostrum solution, what you find is 10-line geodesics. A null geodesic with an angular momentum, they cannot get to the center of the black hole, essentially because they define a potential, which is this one, which at some finite point it becomes infinite. Okay, so they define an infinite potential and they are deflected by it. Okay, so they cannot get to the center of the black hole. But in the case of null geodesics without angular momentum, they can get to the center of the black hole. Okay, and what do they find there is that their path ends at this point. Okay, so they get to the center of the black hole in finite time, and again, since their radial coordinates has to be positive, so there is no possibility of further extension. So you have a geodesic, incomplete geodesic. So your space time is singular. Okay, so this is something that is related just to the behavior of individual geodesics, which is good to see that. You can detect your space-time singular just by looking at this. But there are two questions. Okay? The first thing is try to understand why your geodesic is going to be over at some point. What is the physical reason behind this? And even if your space-time is geodesically complete, this doesn't mean that you could cross through a region where the curvature grows without bound. Okay? So in other words, what is the meaning of curvature divergences? Okay. So we have the intuitive view that curvature divergences is something that should be related to the existence of arbitrarily large tidal forces. So as I was showing you the picture of the Tuesday seminar with this astronaut that is spaghettized in two directions. So what happens to this observer? Okay, so if there are tidal forces that applying a force upon head and your feet and your body, are you going to be destroyed or not? Okay. We have still again the same problem with the issue of coordinate, the choice of coordinate bases. So, so we need to find some kind of approach that allows us to study this issue of tidal forces, but at the same time making sure that our disorder is not going to depend on that choice of coordinates. So we need to do something. We need to find something which is invariant, okay, that does not depend on coordinates. Okay. Fortunately, this has been studied for many years. To the best of my knowledge, the first one that studied this was Tipler.
the 60s and 70s. Okay. Also, Ellis. Well, Ellis is not here, but. Yeah, he has a paper of 68 or something like that. So, really long time ago, where he studied this thing. And also, Florlack and Clark. Okay, so everything this is about late 60s, beginning of 70s, where these guys try to understand what happens to a server that crosses a tension where the curvature can grow without bound. Okay. So these two decades ago, then two decades later, on these results, there were some refinements to include other cases that were not included into this category. But the idea, basically the idea that has emerged from this kind of analysis is that there are at least two kinds of singularities. I think it was Tipler who introduced this classification, which is strong and weak singularities. Okay? But this idea of strong and weak means that you could have a space-time where curvature scalars are divergent. But anyway, a physical observer that is crossing this region could be destroyed or not destroyed. Okay? So it seems a little bit counterintuitive, the idea that if a curvature grows without bounds and if you are a physical observer, you can cross this region without being destroyed. But this is actually what is behind this idea, that this can happen. When this happens, and that your observer is not destroyed during the transit, you go to this weak singularity. If the observer is unavoidable destroyed, then the singularity is strong. So clearly, it's a real singularity that destroys the observers. Okay? This is something that is independent from the USC completeness issue. Okay? So this is a different criterion. So your spacetime could be geodesically complete, but the curvature scalars can be divergent, and in such a way that the singularity is strong, so the individual geodesics can cross, but the physical body, which is made out, has a finite extension, cannot cross. Is destroyed in this process. Okay, and you will say that this is a real singularity because the services are always destroyed. Okay. So we are going to see this a little bit in mathematical terms. So essentially, behind all these ideas, behind all this criterion, there is always the same idea. The same idea that instead of modeling an observer with a geodesic, because it's a single particle, physical observers are made of many particles. So what you are going to do is to make an idealization of an observer, which is something like it's a set of geodesics, okay, which are traveling in space. Okay, so you have a parameter pointing here. Okay, so you are traveling around the different parts of your body are traveling in geodesic motion, okay, in free falling. And these all these geodesics have a fine parameter that tells you how you are moving in time. Okay, so this is the affine parameter. Okay, and the only interaction that you have here is gravitation. But since you are going to go through regions where there are strong gravitational forces, you want to know what are going to be the forces between different parts between different geodesics that made up the body. Okay, so you need to something that measure how these objects. How these tools are going to feed different forces. So this is done in terms of a congruence. So the congruence is just a set of geodesics in free-falling motion. Okay. A congruence is defined just in terms of two parameters. Okay. This is the movement of the geodesic, which is described in terms of a fine parameter, lambda. And on a different parameter, psi, which is this one. Okay. Okay, so essentially the free parameter tells you, gives you information about the direction of the movement, and this parameter tells you information about how the different geodesics in the congruence are related to the other. Okay, so the whole congruence is described in terms of this. Okay, so for a given geodesics in this congruence, you can define always a tangent vector, okay, which is going to be simply the derivative of x mu, respecto a lambda, okay? When psi is equal to constant. Okay? This defines your tangent vector in this direction of the congruence. Okay? And there's a second thing, which is what is called the Jacobi vector. Okay. The Jacobi vector is defined like sif mu, which is the derivative x mu of sped to time, okay, when the form parameter is constant. Okay, this is the Jacobi vector, Jacobi theorem. Okay, so these are the two vectors that you can define with these two parameters. Okay, and the Jacobi vectors is what is really important in our case, because the Jacobi vector satisfies an equation from this quantum world. This equation is called the geodesic deviation equation. Okay? So the Jacobi deviation equation that you can find in any textbook, simply, the second derivative of the Jacobi vector with respect to the fine parameter plus the components of the Riemann tensor alpha, beta, mu, nu, theta, mu, this is equal to zero. Okay? So this is the y ahora si te digo la ecuación, ¿qué es derivativo? Respecto a lambda. This is defined. T, tangent vector, times covariant derivative of the Jacobi field. Okay? Sale de diferencias. Okay, so the Jacobi vector, Jacobi field, satisfies this equation, which is the geodesic equation, and that tells you the evolution in time of these Jacobi vectors in this congruence. Okay, so this is the meaning of this vector. Now, you can express this Jacobi vector because the Jacobi vector can be expressed in a basis, a normal basis, theta alpha, or two, something like some basis alpha a, e a. Okay, and when A goes 1, 2, 2, and 3. Okay? It can be expressed in some basis, like this. And the point is that this choice of basis is not unique. Depends. You have freedom to choose this coordinate basis. Okay? So this is not good, because we want to find something that is invariant, that do not depend on the basis. So we can, if you have freedom to express the Jacobi vector in different basis, this is potentially problematic. But the point is that you can avoid this problem simply saying that your Jacobi field, okay, the components of the Jacobi fields that are here, okay, can be related to the Jacobi field at some value of the congruence. For example, let's have the congruence here, lambda A, okay, lambda I. So the value of the components of the Jacobi field at some initial value of the congruence is related to the components of the Jacobi field at any other value of lambda. And this is given by some matrix. Okay. So this is a matrix. Okay? The particular details of the matrix depends on the problem you are considering. Okay? But you can always relate it this way. Okay? So again, the Jacobi field at some point that appears here, some initial condition. So the Jacobi field at any other future time is related to the original one via some matrix. Okay.
Sorry, it's z alpha, is that a vector for each value of alpha?
Yeah, the alpha, there is some alpha.
So it's like a vector of vectors.
Yeah. Okay, so you have this relation. It could happen. Sometimes happen that all the components of, because well, since this equation provides you six independent fields, which are C theta A, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, and 2,
two derivatives.
Okay.
It could happen that all these components as of finite value could be all zero. So in this case, this is not valid. Okay. But you can define this transformation not using these Jacobi fields, but the derivatives. Okay. So there is no problem on this. So what they do is that to define Tipler is to define something that does, which is the volume invariant, so on lambda. And this is going to be the determinant of all these issues, okay? So it's the determinant of three of these solutions, okay? So there are three independent solutions of this equation. This equation gives you three independent solutions. Okay, so you get these three solutions and put them here. Okay, and you can define this volume element like the determinant of this. And when you do this, using this object that appears here, you get that your volume element point lambda, it's simply the determinant of this matrix appears here, okay, times the volume at the initial point. Okay. So via the Jacobi fields, solving the geodesic equation gives you three Jacobi fields that you introduce here, define the determinant, this gives you a volume element. And since the Jacobi fields at any time can be related to the Jacobi fields at some initial time via this matrix, so you can transform this volume element into the determinant of this matrix times the volume of the initial Jacobi fields at this time. Okay. And what they tell you is a Stone-Weak criteria. What they prove in the papers is that if the limit of the volume element, lambda, when lambda goes to some point, if this volume approaches to zero, this is a strong singularity. So the physical, the intuitive meaning of this is that you have some volume element at some point. Okay, this volume element is independent of the choice of coordinates. Okay, and you can follow the evolution of this volume element in the congruence as time goes on, using this transformation with this matrix to find the final volume. Okay, if at some point, when the affine parameter approaches to some point, this volume element goes to zero, then the physical interpretation is that the tidal forces crosses the object. Okay. It leads. It seems to be in conflict with what I was telling you that this observer and the tidal forces feel a different force at the head and the feet in such a way that can be split apart. I'm telling you that in the Schwarzschild solution, what happens actually is the opposite. The observer is crossed. It's completely crossed to a zero volume. The meaning of this is that it's true that the tidal forces in a radial direction tends to spaghettize you, okay, to leave apart the body, but the forces in the angular direction tend to do the opposite, to cross the body, okay? And when you compare these two things, the effect that tends to leave you apart and the forces that tend you to cross you, the latter is winning, okay? The latter is strong. The final effect in the Schwarzschild case is that you are cross to see the volume. Okay? This is what happens in the Schwarzschild solution. So this is sometimes when it goes to zero, this is called crossing type singularities. Okay. So it seems according to this, what happens in the Schwarzschild case, it looks natural to say that you have a real singularity, because if you are a physical body. And the final effect of the tidal forces is to crush you to see the volume, so you cannot survive to this thing. Okay, even it puts you into trouble because everything is classical, so it could say, well, this is classical, so you are crushed to see the volume, but particles that made up the body will survive independently because if the space time is geodesically complete, in the Schwarzschild case, it's not geodesically complete. But you could have a space-time with crossing type singularity, but the space is basically complete. But one would also say that this space-time is singular because the particles are not just point-like classical objects. They have a quantum nature, okay? So it would be hard to justify the US space-time with a crossing type singularity, no matter the US behavior. The behavior of US6 is going to be regular if you have these things, okay? So this is a second criterion to check whether your space time is singular or not, which is independent of your geodesically complete issue. The other criterion, like was showing you in the seminar, of trying to hitting the black hole with some kind of wave and try to see whether this wave can survive this problem, to this encounter, or whether you cannot define properly the problem. Okay.
Just a minor point following on other people's questions. For the fact that you introduce another set of basis vectors, EA, I can't understand the necessity for introducing another set of basis vectors. Mm-hmm. I mean, your space-time, you already implicitly put a set of basis vectors on. Z mu already has implicitly a set of basis vectors. Mm-hmm. Why?
But yeah, because mu is a space-time index,
yeah.
Okay? But the geodesic equation, A is the basis of the lake that gives you the components in some basis of this vector. But at the same time, this equation is not providing you a single Jacobi field, providing three different Jacobi fields. So they have like three indices playing at the same time, okay, labeling different things.
For each tangent vector, you get another solution.
Yeah, it's that this equation tells you three different solutions. Each of these solutions has a four space-time dimensions index, okay, the time and other components. And each of these objects can be expanded in a basis, okay, of the Jacobi fields. Okay.
Sorry.
Yes.
Are there any cases where that limit goes to infinity?
Yes.
Of zero?
That's it. Okay. That's what you need to do. So. The case where the limit, the lambda approaches to some value of p lambda is finite. This is a weak singularity that does not destroy bodies. And what you say is that limit lambda goes to lambda a, more than lambda, goes to infinity. The origin of the source by deep layer, etc., doesn't cover this case. They don't know what to do with it. They don't know how to give it a physical meaning to this. So they claim nothing about what's happening. Okay. So if, from the source of deep crack case or whatever, you cannot say what's happening. Okay. There are some people in the 90s, like Nolan and Ori, that tried to study what is happening in this case, but it's not clear. So essentially, this is out of the results of this criterion. Okay.
What do you mean, roughly speaking, it's not clear? I mean, because if you compare that with, I don't know, for instance, well, of course you can compare that, but cosmological standard singularity, right, which for given cosmological problem, they satisfy, is the same kind of thing.
But some of the future singularities. Yeah, well, actually the only physical singularity is the big thing, which is the basically complete. The other, what is the meaning of these things? Because it's both. I mean, if you have a still large structure, mm-hmm. and it's a singularity, it's going to be probably taken apart because of these forces. But it doesn't mean that the individual objects are going to be destroyed. Okay. And how can you make quantum theory in future singularities?
No, I understand. When you said that that was not clear, but isn't it clear that the body is going to be destroyed?
No.
But it's inflated to infinity. Right, so like a...
Yeah, it's a case that...
A room with infinite volume.
Yeah.
I don't know. If nuclear forces can survive...
Well, essentially, yeah, that's it. But essentially, is that all these results are dealing with point-like singularities. Singularities that happen in a point. So the idea that you have a point and you are crushed to see the volume, quite clear that it's not, nothing's going to happen, that, I mean, nothing is going to survive. But what's happening in the singularity is not happening in a point, in a finite surface. How you can compare, because as you said, in the social case, it's counterintuitive that you have a crashing time singularity with the, when the radial effect stretches you in one direction and pulls from you in the other. But who is winning? Suppose that you have a singular situation where each thing compensates to each other. And these things, you know, you need to deal with invariant objects, invariant quantities. And the only invariant quantity you have here is the volume. Okay? So this thing that this is being taken apart in this direction, but the other, so what is happening to the body? So this is not trivial. So you need to find some kind of measure that is invariant, that does not depend on this thing. So this is why we are using the volume invariant.
So why is it not clear that it's just destroyed anything that has a finite?
Well, this question. Yeah.
It seems pretty even more obvious than the zero volume to me, which I'm clearly
because
wrong.
If you have a point line singularity, and in Schwarzschild case, and you have something on somebody that goes to infinity, how can something go to infinity in something that goes to zero? So you know. So the volume of the server goes to infinity.
Yes.
But the volume of the space that you are seeing goes to zero. So how can that be possible? In this case, it's clear in the sense that you have a zero volume in your space-time, and the observer is constraining the space-time and squares it into the same volume that the space-time is converging to. But how can a situation be where you have divergence volume? The observer is observing as something that goes to zero volume. So
this is related to caustics, right? Hmm? This is related to caustics.
To clock sticks.
To caustics. So I have a phase space. Hmm? And I follow a group of convergent geodesics, and they can go through singular points as well, right? That's what I think it's in. Yeah. And you can get points where the volume goes to zero. Mm-hmm. But so I imagine I have to calculate the force between the particles as well to really know if the body, like a person, can crash.
Yes.
Because you've predicted that non interacting geodesics will pass through this point and go to zero.
Mm-hmm.
But there's no estimate of the force that actually crush them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but because
I mean, in a black hole, shall we
say? Yeah, it's calculating the force is something that is necessarily conflict.
Yeah.
Star also.
Yeah.
But these things are something that do not depend on these things. They are simply volume elements.
So yes.
They are invariant things. No.
Yeah.
So it's a good criterion, but it does not fulfill all the possibilities.
Yeah.
Okay. So as Howard was saying, how do you interpret this issue of the volume element in future singularities? But you know, the future singularities happen in the evolution, in the future evolution of the universe, where the Hubble factor can grow without bound at a finite time.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so it's not clear how to maybe you know whether people have tried to apply this issue of volume elements to objects in the future singularities.
No,
because there is a second related thing to the Tipler and Clorac, which is instead of making a computation of volume elements, is making the integrals of some components of the Riemann tensor, and making sure that these components are finite. You know what I mean? So there are some integrals that are called essentially, is to integrate some components of the Riemann tensor around the affine parameter. And if these integrals are finite, then it's usually said that this is a weak singularity. I think that this is a weaker statement than this issue volume singularities. Okay. Because you can always compute the Riemann main integrals, that's much easier. But that thing is usually much more difficult to do. So people are usually make a classification of singularities making these integrals. Okay, I think it's Tipler and Clorac. Yeah. So they are two different kinds of integrals and making sure that these integrals are finite in order to see whether the space-time is weak or strong. Okay. But I think it's a weaker criterion than this one. This is stronger. Okay.
Can I ask something? So before you would get so in the infinite case, infinite volume scenario. Before you get to infinity, there must be some value of lambda
mm-hmm.
such that the volume is so big that it would take a speed faster than light to inform the outside geodesics that they are being, they should be pulled towards to get together.
That's something I mentioned in my seminar, that another way of checking this, to try to see this, where photons can travel in a causal way to inform the other parts of the body that there are some interactions being transmitted.
Penrose argument, yeah.
This is even much more difficult to check than this is.
Okay. But whenever you have a limit going to infinity, you know that there will be some lambda before that where this happens for sure, and so it is a singularity where you're ripped apart for sure. I think.
This is intuitive, but it's not the case.
Okay.
It's, why also you there is a counterexample of that. It's something where the volume element seems to go to infinity, but the causal, because essentially, but to make a long story short, is that you can compute the free falling system of coordinates, how a photon is traveling from one part of the congruence to another, and try to make sure that this is inside the cone of light, in the sense that is causal, this interaction is causal. And there are cases where the volume element can go to infinity, but still the interactions be causal. The light can cross to the body in a causal way. Okay. More questions about this thing? You can go directly to the papers and deeply cover and all that. Also in the book by Hawking and Ellis. Hawking and Ellis. Hawking and Ellis is also, this is also spread. Okay. In total. But again, this with Dippler and all the others made this criterion, they were thinking always on singularities that happen on a point. Okay, essentially the black holes and in the early universe. They're not thinking on things like late-time singularities. Okay. So it has to be careful because there are underlying hypotheses that sometimes are not explicitly stated to see in what situations this is valid or not. Okay. Essentially this is valid for pre-light singularities that happens in black holes or in the early universe. Okay. So, what I'm going to tell you now is that different attempts that people have tried to do in order to solve the problem with singularities. Okay. So essentially there are two key points. One is that the problem is in the matter sector, the Einstein equations. So because the matter description that you are using on your black hole is not good enough. So try to modify the left-hand side to see what is happening. This is what I'm going to tell you right now. And later that, there is the other approach, which is try to say that there is something wrong on the left-hand side, and try to modify this side, okay? So we're going to see the attempts that people have built in the literature to build space-times that are regular just by modification on the left-hand side, okay? So the first thing that I'm going to leave you is something which is, well, has different names, but let's say, non-linear electromagnetic fields. Okay. So the idea of this is to, well, there are different approaches to this issue. The first, this idea originally came from the fact that people were looking for solutions to the Coulomb's divergence problem, so the fact that once you compute the Coulomb field of a polarized charge, and you go to the center of the charge, this field diverges. Okay, so the energy density at this point diverges as well. So this is a well-known problem in classical electrodynamics, the quantum electrodynamics solve. Okay, but still the idea is to say that a Maxwell field cannot account for the light electromagnetic field very close to the center of the source. Okay, so Coulomb field. But this time, you have the Coulomb field goes like Q over R squared. So when you go to the center of the solution, so the field blows up, the energy blows up, and this doesn't work, okay? So before quantum quantum mechanics to solve this problem, people were looking for modifications of the electromagnetic field very close to the center to see whether you could avoid this problem with singularities. The first attempt that somebody did about this was for body infinite electrodynamics. It was simple enough in the sense that you were looking for, in the same way that that the squared root modification of the velocity was introduced in special relativity, they tried to do the same here. Okay. So what they did is that instead of writing an electromagnetic field in a certain way, okay, they modified this around here. You say something like 2 beta squared, 1 minus square root, 1 minus. So they introduce this with this square root here. Okay. This is called the body infinite electrodynamics. Well, it's quite popular still nowadays because it has a lot of interesting properties, it analyzes in string theory, blah blah blah. But the important point about the historical and important point about body infinite electrodynamics that was introduced, as I said, in analogy with special relativity, is that when you compute the electromagnetic field associated to this electrodynamics, you get that the electromagnetic field goes something like beta over beta squared, minus squared, plus q squared. Okay, so beta is a new parameter, it's a new scale for saying this is in the theory that could come from different places, as I said, in theory. This is beta squared, minus squared, plus q squared, beta q. Okay, so this goes to q over to infinity. So this goes to q over r squared. Okay? So a large distance is you recover Coulomb's field. And this scale determines the point at which modification as compared to Maxwell electrodynamics are going to be felt. Okay? If you compute the energy density and the total energy associated to this, so the energy density in half space time, 0 to infinity, r to the far, we are, this is finite, okay? Because essentially, this goes like E squared, so R squared, E squared, when you integrate this from 0 to infinity, you get something which is finite. Okay, as opposed to classical, to Maxwell field. Okay, so the question is, if body infinite electrodynamics can solve the problem with the divergence of Coulomb's field, just by introducing this nonlinear modification. Okay, so you solve the problem with singularities in the sense of the singularities of the fields. So could the same mechanism operate in gravitational context to solve the problem with the space-time singularities? This was the original question, and lots of people have devoted their research to study these things. The second point is that, as I said other day, so physical black holes are assumed to be uncharged because essentially the charge tends to neutralize during this during astrophysical processes. But still, the black holes retains a tiny charge. Okay? Even if this charge is negligible in astrophysical terms, the fact that the charge is present changes completely the structure of the corresponding black hole solution. The Western Boston solution with a single charge have very different properties compared to the source solution. Okay? So maybe if the you replace Maxwell with something nonlinear, you could obtain something that changes the structure of the solution in such a way that you can avoid singularities. Okay, that was the original motivation. And in addition to this, there is another fact that if you take into account quantum effects close to the center of the black hole, I think we already talked a little bit about this, and you need to include, when you try to include quantum effects, you can study this problem in terms of FFT Lagrangians. Okay? Because solving the Einstein equations in combination with quantum electrodynamics is possible in practice. So what you try to do instead is to approach this problem using electromagnetic effective field theory. Fortunately, in quantum electrodynamics, effective field theory and some energies is is a problem very well studied. And what they find is that if you consider the corrections by the quantum vacuum to the electromagnetic field at low in our energies, to get the zero order is precisely Maxwell's theorem, I think it has to be, but you get corrections. Corrections in the electromagnetic field objects. Okay. So essentially, if you write, you say that Maxwell is some function x, what quantum electrodynamics tells you is that the first order correction to Maxwell electrodynamics, okay, so let's say effectively the theory of quantum electrodynamics, is going to be Maxwell plus things on constant alpha that goes x squared. This alpha is related to the parameters of quantum electrodynamics, so the electron charge appears here, the fine Stator constant also appears here. So essentially what you do is you get quantum electrodynamics, make an expansion in series, okay? And what you get is that these effects at some low energies can be resumed in terms of series of this curvature, of this curvature, so this feeling variable. And they appear always like this way, okay? So in classical scenarios, where the personal field, when the defects are not very high, you don't feel these terms. You only feel classical electrodynamics. But if you start computing higher and higher energies, you will get a series of terms like this. And if you go to full lengths, then you find quantum electrodynamics, where you solve the problem with the divergence of the Coulomb field. But it turns out that even this simple Lagrangian, first order in expansion of quantum electrodynamics, even this kind of Lagrangian already solves the problem with the divergence of the electrons of Coulomb's divergence. So from these two arguments, this Lagrangian has been constructed from an analogy with special relativity. And this thing comes from low energy expansion of quantum electrodynamics. It looks like the issue with the singularity of the Coulomb field can be resolved using these kind of things. So why not consider these kind of theories in the gravitational context to see whether they can avoid this issue with space-time singularities? Okay, so this is the main motivation behind this thing. Okay, so the idea is that to work as general as possible, you can construct a Lagrangian, which is some function, let's say phi of x, okay, and specify. We don't know still what it does. What is this? So we made an action, which is essential for x minus e, which is going to the Einstein theory of Lagrangian, u squared, plus this function. Okay. So if phi is equal to x, this is Maxwell. If not, you have something different, something that goes beyond Maxwell. And you can try to solve the Einstein equation with this matter source to see what happens. Okay. So you need to solve Einstein equations in the square division. Okay. This is for a static spherical symmetric line element, I indicate the Schwarzschild solution. So you get Vs squared. Function u bar v t squared minus v bar minus 1 v r squared minus r squared v omega squared. So the typical line there. Okay. Now, if you remember when we were discussing the design of the solution, I told you that it's usually better to write with a mixed coordinate any unit tensor. Because when you do this and you write Einstein equations in mixed coordinates, it tells you this energy momentum tensor satisfies a symmetry for this electromagnetic field, which is that the temporal components of the electromagnetic tensor are equal to this component. Okay. It's a very useful symmetry when you discuss black hole solutions because it tells you that the spherical symmetric black hole from which the energy momentum tensor satisfies this condition, these two components are going to be equal to each other. Okay. So from here, it follows immediately that A is going to be equal to B. Essentially, because if you remember the calculation of the Reisner-Nostrom case, you get that the t00 and g11 were more or less the same thing. They were only a difference of a over b functions. Okay. So you write this in mixed coordinates, these two factors ab are going to disappear, and what you are going to have is that essentially they are the same equation modulo some constant. And this allows you to identify a with it, okay? This is a property not only of this kind of models or electromagnetic fields, but any model that has this source symmetry tells you that these two functions have to be equal to each other. The same happens in Schwarzschild, obviously. In Schwarzschild is it zero, both of them. So this is trivially satisfied, so you get always this. Okay? So your function, your line element, spherical symmetric line element with two functions, with this map, which is symmetry of the source, it always transforms into that these two functions are the same. So you only have one function to solve. Okay. In addition, you have Maxwell field equations. So provide derivative of phi with respect to x, mu. These are the electromagnetic field equations. Okay. And this is a consequence of the Einstein field equations via the Bianchi equation. All the details of this derivation is, I will send you an email. Okay. So this is just the main idea. So the idea is that you get the Einstein equation with this symmetric variable Newton tensor, you can get these two functions. The electromagnetic field equations are consistent with the Einstein equations, they are a consequence of that, because of this. Okay. And you only have to solve one of the Einstein equations for a single independent function, a. Okay. When you do this, what you get is that this function a is going to be Maxwell the Schwarzschild limit, okay, but something which essentially is 1 over r integral of r to infinity r squared with b. This is the solution. Okay. So we can check that it works in the Maxwell case. Maxwell has the bp is equal to q squared divided by r to the 4. Maxwell. Okay. When you do this, so you have that this integral is the integral. So, 1 n. R, so it's integral of q squared, r squared, star. Okay, so r squared. Okay, so this is by the most. Okay, so from the inner momentum tensor of the Maxwell field, you can compute this component, put it inside here, and you get a Lesser-Newton solution. If you have a different theory of electrodynamics, let's say polyfill electrodynamics or any other, you just need to compute the TTT component, make this integration, and you get something which is different from the Lesser-Newton solution. Okay. Well, let's see what happens with polyfill electrodynamics. So here's there. So you have this Lagrangian, these are the solutions for the magnetic field, and when you get this, when you do this, you get something which is far to n. So this is the Schwarzschild piece. Okay, and you get something which is going to be some hypergeometric function, well, some functions of let's say epsilon of r, because they are hypergeometric functions, so etc. Okay. So you will see this if you are interested in reading this. So you get something new, that the far distances goes to the Maxwell, to the Coulomb's field, but near the center there are differences. Okay? So the solution close to the central point of the black hole is not the same as the Maxwell. Okay, so this epsilon of r will go when r goes to infinity, q squared divided by r to the 4. Not only depends on r, but on q. Something like this. So there is an involved dependence here, or this with boy is involved. More info. Okay, so there are many interesting properties about this kind of metric, but you can compare this with the less than not known case. So in the less than not known, you have the dysfunction represented black holes with the horizons, spin black holes, connected singularities, essentially because here are equal to zero. The curvature invariance goes to infinity. What happens in this boring for electrodynamics? But if electrodynamics, we plot and roll the same, and some of our A, it's the syntactic lines. Okay. When you plot this, depending on the combination between Q and beta, you get different structures. One of them corresponds to the fact corresponds to solutions that are very similar to Hessian Nostrum, in the sense that they can have two horizons, inner horizon, a string black hole or no horizons, like a singularity. But in addition, you have solutions like this, that look like Schwarzschild, okay, they have a single horizon. There are even some more strange situations where the metric at the center can be finite, can be positive, or can be negative, or finite. Okay, so depending on this interplay between Q and beta, you could have solutions for which the metric at the center is finite. Nonetheless, if you compute curvature scalars like this one, these still go to infinity. So even if you make the metric to be finite at the center, the curvature scalars are still finite. And the space-time at the same time is geodesically incomplete. Okay, so you still have a singularity at the center of the solutions. Actually, there is some kind of general result by which it tells you that if you are dealing with electrostatic solutions from a theory of electrodynamics, which is well defined in the sense that it satisfies energy conditions, then all these kind of models, no matter what inferior or what any other, are always going to tell you, you are always going to think that the curvature at the center diverges. These kind of models can have interesting properties and can be studied from the point of view of collections to the Hessian-Nostrum solution because of quantum polarization of effects of the electromagnetic field. That's fine, that's okay. In order to take a more realistic description of the physics inside, but it do not solve, it doesn't solve the problems of simple singularities. Okay. And this is to be a quite a general result for electrostatic fields. Nonetheless, there is something.
So I can ask something. What is beta?
Beta is a new scale that you have in the theory.
You what?
A new scale, new parameter.
So it's just a number.
It has dimensions, but yeah, it's a number. Okay. Yeah, so it's some length scale, since it has dimensions, everything of length square. But it's something that you introduce by hand in your theory.
Okay.
And the motivations could be, as I said, in string theory, this emerges in some limit of the theory. So it's related, in that case it will be related to string extension. Okay. If you are in quantum electrodynamics, this parameter mu alpha that appears in this x squared term is related to the fine Stutter constant and the electron mass. Okay. Nonetheless, there is a widespread philosophy, as I was telling you in the seminar, which is okay. I start with some nonlinear electrodynamics, I get something that cannot avoid the divergence of curvature. So why don't I do the other way around? Start with the line element to make sure that curvature are finite, and then causal theory comes from. The first historical example about this was built by Marie. Okay. What Bardeen did was to define the function. This method. If you compute the curvature scalars for this method, all of them are finite. Okay? So it's the regular black hole in the context of here. And how can this be possible? We already said that this is, if the hypothesis of the singularity theorems are fulfilled, then you cannot have these kind of things in a relative. So any of the inner conditions has to be violated. Any of the singularity, or the conditions of the singularity theorems have to be violated. Actually, what they do in these kind of solutions is to avoid this, introducing something which is not explicitly formulated in the singularity theorems, but is the hypothesis that your space-time, the structure of your space-time, is topologically trivial. It does not contain non-topological structures. Topological non-trivial structures. So the, what they do in this solution is to introduce something which is non-trivial. Okay. This was not recognized when the first solution was obtained. Was much later before. After that, was people realized what was happening with this solution. Actually, it's a, this is a very interesting solution in the sense that it has a very interesting properties. Okay. But this opened the door to study solutions in general relativity with non-trivial topology. People started to, because of different reasons, people started to consider more seriously the idea of solutions with non-trivial topology as a way out of the constraints of the singularity theories. So, because of this, there is a full field of things that are designed to, which are designed to make use of these properties. People realized what was happening with this solution, actually. So this is a very interesting solution in the sense that it has a very interesting properties. Okay? But this opened the door to study solutions in general relativity with non-trivial topology. So people started to, because of different reasons, people started to consider more seriously the idea of solutions with non-trivial topology as a way out of the constraints of the singularity theories. So, because of this, there is a full field of things that are designed to, which are designed to make use of this property, non-trivial topology, in order to build regular models. Okay? And the whole field about this is the idea of morphology. Okay? The last thing I'm going to talk about today. Okay, so the concept of a wormhole is very simple. It's a solution of some additional field equations that allows you to connect two causally disconnected regions in space-time. Okay? Some kind of tunnel or bridge in space-time that allows you to go from one point to the other. Okay? And usually, the standard representation you will see of a wormhole is two throats connected by a tube, and that leads you to asymptotically flat space-times. These two asymptotically flat space-times do not even need to be the same. They could be different portions of the same space-time or different space-times. Okay. This is something that was introduced first by Wheeler in this 55. That's by Wheeler. So it was forgotten for many long times ago, for many years, until actually the history is very curious in the sense that it was torn. Who writes some lecture notes that were designed in order to give professors in the USA material in order to teach students general relativity using something that they considered not to be physically realistic, which was wormholes. But after doing this, they realized it, and people realized it, that maybe there could be some physical content after all to this. So people started to take in this issue much more seriously than in the past. Okay, so the best reference that you can find about what a wormhole is a book by Pister, which is called Traverse Our Wormholes. It's for the 92. If you are interested, I have a digital copy of this book. Just everything you need to know about wormholes is contained here. So So essentially, what we want is to build a metric that allows you to connect to causally disconnected regions. So we need to write a line element that allows us to do this. Okay? So usually, all constructions in one-form physics, or almost all, start directly with the line element. This philosophy of getting, putting first the line element and then writing the Einstein equation back in order to find the matter that supports this geometry. In order to do this, you write the line element. Okay. It's going to be some function. D squared. Minus. D L squared. Minus R. Square. L. Okay? This is usually the metric that you write. We are a static spherical symmetric metric, so we have two independent functions. The system of coordinates is chosen in an appropriate way in order for these two functions, the second one, to appear here instead of here, like we are used to. In the Schwarzschild case, we usually have a function here and here. But here, in this case, the freedom of your metric appears here instead of in this place. And this is not, it seems like there is some kind of radial coordinate or some radial coordinate that appears here. So it's a little bit strange the first time you see it, okay? Actually, you can rewrite this in a more canonical way, just simply saying that make this a change of coordinates. VL, VR, make this change of coordinates equal to 1 divided by square root of 1 V of R divided by R. If you introduce this change of coordinates here, what you get is that your line element, this is the same, so this is V R. Et squared minus b I squared minus b r squared minus r minus I squared b minus r. Okay. Now this form of the metric is much more canonical, so we have two free functions here in the time and radial coordinates, and this is the standard radial coordinate. Yes. With this new coordinate. So you could do the other way around, start from this line element, which is canonical, and go back to this one. Okay. So you see that this is a radial coordinate here, that appears here, okay, over there. But the radial coordinate here is this one. The whole of the radial coordinate is played by this thing. And so this is a function of the radial coordinate. Okay. So instead of being the radial coordinate, is a function of the radial coordinate. The point with this is that this change of coordinates to go from this canonical line element to this one is not always allowed. This has to be well defined. Okay. So in order for this change of coordinates to be allowed, then you need to impose a number of conditions upon your metric. Okay. So the coordinate L covers all lengths, and the coordinate R. This is the coordinate that appears here. Okay. Coordinate R still has to be positive. Okay. This has to be in agreement with the fact that we have in the canonical form of the line element. Okay. But this line coordinate is not constrained by this. Okay. So it can flow from minus infinity to plus infinity. Now the word traversable usually what it means. That there are no horizons. If the solution has horizons, there is a different characterization of this spacetime. So we are not going into this because usually people are interested in traversable solutions. Okay. And we need to have two asymptotically fractions. Okay. So essentially, it means that when L goes to infinity, minus infinity. Okay. So to 5 L has to go to 1. Okay, so this is asymptotic practice. Okay, this is the requirement of asymptotic practice. Asymptotic practice also requires that this function of the radial coordinate goes to the radial coordinate. Okay, otherwise we have no asymptotic practice. So this means that the limit when L goes to plus or minus infinity of the radial function compared to the radial coordinate respect to the radial coordinate has to go to 1. Okay? So these two conditions are imposed for asymptotic, to have asymptotic flatness of your space time. Okay, so we have defined to this radial coordinate and the radial function of the radial coordinate. We have defined that the reservoir has no horizons and asymptotic flatness. But this is still not a wormhole. In order to have the wormhole, what you need to have is that your function, or your radial function, needs to have a MIMO. Okay? In order to have, so this will be that this function, they have some MIMO. Minus R of L. Okay? Without loss of generality, you can choose the radial coordinate for the minimum to be at L equal to 0. Okay? You can always rescale your coordinate system in order to put the minimum correspond to L equal to 0. Okay? So, at the center, this is the minimum radial of the coordinate is called the throat. Essentially, on one side, yes?
Sorry, how can you have a minimum in R of L if the gradient can't ever be zero?
Sorry, the minimum is?
The gradient function on the left, dl by dr, can't ever be zero.
Yeah.
So how can you have a minimum?
How can you have a minimum here?
Oh, wait, no, sorry, I think it's okay.
Sorry. Okay. Okay, so these are the conditions that you demand for a spacetime to be to represent a wormhole. Okay. So, if you get all these conditions into account, so the radial function has to be positive. A function or radial coordinate can go from one side to the other. It's something that's going to have a minimum, let's say R0. This minimum, this goes there, and here it goes there. Okay, so this is the usual representation of the radial function of a wormhole. So, what you have is that in order to cover the whole space-time, you will need a single charge in terms of this coordinate L, but you need two charges in terms of this radial function R. Essentially because in this change of coordinates there are two signs, okay? Because you have taken some square root. I want to define this, because essentially you define this change in this way. Okay? To go from here to there. Okay? So essentially there are two signs here, and these two signs correspond to the two sides of this thing. Okay? Now, the next question is, how can I guarantee that my space-time is going to have this bounds in the radial function? Okay. Because of this equation, okay, it means that then at the minimum value of the radial coordinate, what you are going to have is that dr respect to L will be equal to 0. Okay. Or equivalently, it means that dr is going to be infinity. Okay. And if you put this into here, in order for this to be true, you need, like me, the minimum value of the radial coordinate has to be the same value of the minimum coordinate. Essentially, because the throat is going to be located at r equal to r0, and in order for this issue to grow up, you need that to be at r equal to 0 has to be R0, for this to be 0 and this to grow up. Okay. So this solution is characterized by this property in the system of coordinates. Okay. And there are more things that have to be satisfied. Because we are not only happy with the fact that this is equal to, that you have this thing. You need to make sure that this is really a minimum. Okay. So because of the definition of the system of coordinates, have that this is 1 minus b over r, okay, so that equation that appears there. If you detect second derivative with respect to L squared, what you get is that 1 over 2r, b over r minus b dr, this is what you have. Okay? And to be a minimum, and the throw, this has to be greater than 0. Because you need to be a minimum and the expanded to this region. Okay? So you need that this condition has to be greater than 0. And when you get this, when you impose this condition, you get that your function b, derivative of b with respect to r, has to be greater, less than b r divided by r. This is for the clear out condition. Okay? Okay, so the coding, what we have done. We started with this line element, okay, where the two functions appear here and here. And we make sure that in order to convert to this metric from this canonical form of the line element, we need to use this change of coordinates. This change of coordinates tell us that there is some minimum of the other function if this condition is satisfied. But in order to make sure that this is really a minimum, we have to take a second derivative to see that this is going to bounce at this point. And from here, we get this solution, the Frenard condition. Okay. Now, the question that comes is that these solutions seem to be avoiding the constraints of the singularity theorems, in the sense that it looks like you have a geodesically complete space-time. Sincerely, because you are a photon in the Schwarzschild case and you go to this way and you get to the center, there is no possibility of continuation. But here, it looks like there is possibility of continuation. You just bounce it off the region. How can this be possible if we still have the singularity theories? So, in order to... So, what is the condition, that what is the hypothesis of the singularities as is being violated? So, actually, the condition being violated is the energy condition. This can be seen directly from the field of equations. If you write the Einstein equations for this geometry, you get a number of conditions, which is that the energy density is the derivative of p with respect to r, divided by r squared. Okay. They absorb the units of the Einstein constant. Okay? So essentially, the energy density takes this form. You can also write the equations for the pressure equal to blah blah blah, but this is nothing. We are just interested in this one. Okay. This energy density, in particular, the wormhole flow, you can write it to be take that b prime, it's of b prime in the derivative of b respect to r. B prime R0, okay, divided by R0. Okay? In addition, the tangential pressure, because if you have a line element, any element in terms of this diagonal, although tangential pressure and all the pressures, theta phi, say. Okay, so this is the any element in terms of your source. So you have that this pressure can be written to be simply 1 R0. You can show that this is 1 over R0 squared. Okay? So this is enough. There are also expressions for these things, but we are only interested in this because if you try to see what is this plus this, what you get is that replacing all these expressions here, what you get essentially is that this is going to be I'm not going to show you directly, but this is has to be satisfied. This is the condition that you have. When you play with all the things here, you get that this plus this at the throat is less than zero. Plus this cannot be.
because we already know from the energy condition that the wave energy condition that is employed in the singularity theorem tells you that go has to be greater or equal to zero and go plus pt has to be greater than zero. All these conditions have to be satisfied in order for this weak energy condition to be satisfied. But the throat, this condition, which is this one, is violated. So one horse, unavoidably, violated energy conditions at the throat. What about the rest of the space? So far away from the solution, from the one hole throat, the solution can converge to the Schwarzschild solution, which obviously satisfies the energy conditions, or to the Lessen Nostrum, whatever. So it means that there is going to be always a condition of space-time from where this condition that is satisfying the Lessen Nostrum fails to be satisfied. Okay? So there is some region. Okay. See? That tells you the region where the energy conditions are violated. In wormhole physics, you can make this region to be as small as possible. Indeed, it can be made so small that you enter into the field of quantum mechanics, the realm of quantum mechanics. Now, in quantum mechanics, there can be violations of the energy conditions, okay, in tiny regions. So if you make this region to be as small as you wish, in particular, you can make it to be infinitesimally thin, people usually argue that in this region, quantum effects can violate the energy condition in the region, so you could have a wormhole supported by this thing. Okay. But in any case, you always need matter that violates the energy condition, so it's usually said that wormholes are always supported by isotic matter. Now that inflationary and daytime cosmological models are introducing matter that seems to violate the energy conditions, so people working in this field are very happy because it gives them more support to what they are doing. Okay. In any case, wormholes. This is why the Schwarzschild solution cannot be transformed into a wormhole, essentially because the Schwarzschild does not satisfy any conditions. But a wormhole unavoidably violates the energy conditions. Otherwise, how can the Schwarzschild does not be singular? You just make this replacement, go to this thing, and transform the solution into a wormhole. This cannot be made without violating the energy conditions. So, any questions about this issue of wormholes?
So we impose traversable general horizons. So are we not dealing with black holes, connecting two black holes?
You can generalize all these definitions to include wormholes. It's just that this definition doesn't work. You need another change of coordinates, but it's valid. The point is that, we can discuss it, because this is a So usually it's a traversal. The word traversal was going for no horizons, but it can be also done with horizons. And I see where that there is no problem to generalize this definition. Usually the people kept to this idea of traversal because it avoids some kind of problems with causality and all these things. Okay, fine. But essentially because the time that I'm not going to discuss this, of course. It takes a long time.
What about curvature invariance at the throat? Are they finite?
They diverge always. Essentially because they diverge. They are geodesically complete space times by construction, obviously, have to be. So, but usually, most of these cases where you restrict the size of violations to this region, essentially, you put a layer of matter under the form of a delta source. Okay? So essentially, because you need to add on the right-hand side of the equation some kind of matter to realize this structure. So you can put a layer, infinitesimally layer of matter that way. And this infinitesimally small layer under the form of a delta induces divergences in the curvature scalars. So the curvature scalars can be everywhere fine, but there they grow up. They grow up all. To best of my knowledge, they will have always. I don't know of a single case in general relativity where they do not have this. But this year is going to complete this space time. Okay. Just because Mozart of this space time is designed to do precisely this way. The point is that
in the case of the regular black holes in electrodynamics, where you could, you can build models by hand by violating energy conditions where the curvature scalars are finite, but the space-time is still geodesically incomplete. Mm-hmm. In the wormhole case, is the opposite. The space-time is geodesically complete, the curvature scalars generally diverge. Okay. So what does this divergence of the curvature scalars mean? So that is, going back to the beginning of the lesson, you need to go to this criterion, what happens to volume, invariance, or all these things, to a physical observer that is crossing this region. Okay. The VOC can cross individually, but what is going to happen with a physical observer?
And what's the answer?
It depends on the space-time. There are space-time where nothing happens, everything is fine. And there are others where it blows out. Yes?
Will Einstein's equations then allow for a transition material change in topology, or well, basically, do we have any understanding of the mechanism that leads to a change in topology, or is that?
I mean, the Einstein equation tells you nothing about what is the topology of the space-time, because it's a total that comes first, okay? So it's something that you have to add from outside, okay? Usually, when you introduce non-trivial topology, you end up into problems with violation of causality and all these things. Okay. So it's very difficult to introduce topology without getting into problems with issues of causality. But it's something that you have to introduce from outside. It's not in the Einstein equation. It's not included into the singularity theory. No. So it's something that. Yes?
So, very nice question. Then the regions become causally connected.
Yes.
Right. Through the wormhole. Right. And
yes.
In a the reversible point. Way, like from region 1 to region 2 and from region 2 to region 1.
No. The wormholes can only be crossing one. Well, if they are traversal on the horizon, they can go into one side or the other.
Okay.
In the other case, if you have covered them with a horizon, then it's a one way path.
Covering them with one horizon.
Yeah, because these cosmic particles are symmetric. If there is a horizon on one of the sides of the throw,
yeah,
there is another on the other side. Okay. There's a symmetric object. Fixed zero.
But I think you mentioned earlier something like the space time on both sides don't need to be the same.
Yes.
And if they're not the same, maybe your horizon are located in different, slightly different positions? Or?
No, in this cosmic particles they are symmetric. The point is that the if you cover it with a horizon, then the distance that covers the flow can be as large as you wish, because the signature of the metric change. So there can the two regions can be in causal contact through the bridge or the wormhole, but they can be very far away in the space-time. Can be in different places of the space-time. Okay.
So meaning that eventually someone falling in that horizon will go up in the second region, but it will be trapped there because it will find an intermediate that.
No, because the horizon on the other side, you have a horizon. It's a way, one way out. The new horizon on one side is a one way in and one way out, because the orientation of the normal is different.
Yeah.
It's the opposite in both sides. So, but usually, if you want to call it a white hole region,
yeah,
perfectly fine.
Mm-hmm. And more technical one, the rho and p are because you were using the Einstein's equations, right?
Yeah, because of this condition, yes. This condition has to be
satisfied. No, but I mean the expression, just the expression that you provided for rho and p.
You write the Einstein equations, assume that the source, the matter source of the wormhole is this one. You write the Einstein equations, make the particular case where you are at the float, impose this federal condition, and you always get into this. There's no, but you know, Prado knows about this event. Actually, it's not only violates the weak energy condition, but violates all the cosmic energy conditions. Okay. No questions? Okay, if there are no questions, tomorrow we'll talk about the last issue, which is black holes in general relativity. Okay? Thank you.
Thank you.